The views and opinions expressed on this program are those of the participants and do not reflect the views of BronxNet or the program underwriters.
BronxNet. Your voice, your views, your vision.
And good morning to you. Good morning to you in every kind of way. Good morning to you. Good morning to you. Hope you have a beautiful day. We have another episode of Open, the one and only show that opens up the Bronx and the rest of the world to you. I'm your host, the Diggity Diggity Dr. Bob Lee from 107.5 WBLS, your number one source for R&B. I come on just before Lenny Green each and every night, or after Lenny Green. We have a wonderful day planned for you today on Channel 67's Open. Leading off the show will be our Open Nutrition Consultant, Fiorella DiCarlo. She's here today to talk about the importance of childhood nutrition. Very important, and how it can affect their development. Right after that, we'll sit down with Clarence Stanley and Brenda Stewart. Brenda Stewart Luke is here, who will tell us how the Small Business Development Center helps entrepreneurs transform their ideas into successful businesses. And then Charles Cooper will speak out about the upcoming African Day Parade and what to expect from the 60,000-person-led event. Musical guest, B. Clay is here with Isaac Catalay. Isaac Catalay. Now here it is. Did I say it right? Isaac Catalay. Say it again. Catalay, you got to add a little something to it. He's going to perform. He's here with our Music Monday. This is going to be very, very nice. So you don't want to miss it. Stay right here because we are now headed to something very beautiful. We are officially open. Check it out. Good morning, everybody. I'm your host, Dr. Bob Lee, and you're watching Open. Today is Monday, September 17th. We got a very excellent show lined up for you. Great things lined up. Let me see. We're all part of the melting pot, so it's New York. New York and culture is a big part of it right here. Things like Arts on Third, the African Day Parade, all the major street festivals, all the wonderful things that make us a part of the wonderful melting pot here in the city. Last night, we were in Mount Vernon, something called Arts on Third, right outside of the Bronx. And it was a tribute to Heavy D. A tribute to Heavy D. Mom and Dad was there. The whole family was right there. And Dougie Fresh came up. Molly Ma, my daughter Sheena Lee, she sang. Oh, it was fantastic. The Bowlegged Lou came up there. You know, and that's what we're talking about when we're talking about the melting pot.
Oh, yes.
You know, it's a great thing. The father was dancing. The father's like, you know, kind of up in age. Mom was dancing on stage. It was off the hook. And it was very crowded out there. I got pictures. I don't know if we're going to show a few of them, but everybody had a great time. And it was a huge cultural event that brought everybody together. No violence. You know, all too often, they sensationalize all the crazy things that happen in our community. That's Dougie Fresh right there addressing the crowd of thousands. I was on the side over there messing around. I was the host of that.
As you see, that's true school music. I mean, parents, youth, can come out without any profanity in the records. And I think that's so key because that's where hip-hop started. Yeah. It was about bringing people together. Also, I mean, we had our troubling times. There were gangs and stuff like that that were out. But we used music, positive music, hip-hop music, to escape the violence.
Yeah. And, you know, those things, you talk about the gangs and the violence in our streets, that hits the newspapers, hits the TV, hits radio right away, right?
All the time.
We have to create the awareness that there are a lot of wonderful things happening in our community also.
It's always been that way. I mean, we just have to continue to be able to show and join forces with the newer artists today as well, because, I mean, most of the time you hear violence, pain. But they say this is the times that they're living in, but...
Yeah.
They got to be another way to express what they feel in a positive way.
You have an event that brings people together, Kings and Queens.
Yeah, Raising Kings and Queens. I think that's important. Of course, you provide the sound, and you also out there hosting the show. And I think it's great that we continue to do stuff like that, because mm-hmm. it's not only just music, it's health awareness, credit counseling, voters registration. So a lot of different things play a role that I try to bring out to the community so they can learn. And also one of the important things that I want to do next year is bring out something to deal with prostate cancer awareness and have men, because black men don't get tested for prostate cancer. They should get their PSA checked. And
why do you think that is?
Well, I think they don't think it's cool to go to the doctor. Then some of them don't want a doctor to put their finger, you know, back there. They might think
they
it's
feel
gay.
Violated.
But you know what?
Oh, wow.
That can save your life.
Yeah.
You know, and I think it's so important.
And they have other ways of doing that, too.
Yeah, they do. I guess technology has advanced, but still, these are one of the things that we need to bring aware.
But if you need to go catch that finger just to make sure everything is straight, you know?
I think this is Prostate Cancer Awareness a month, I believe. But I think people should just get checked out regardless whether it's that or not.
Right.
But it's so important. Thank you, Bobby, for
chiming in. DJ Cool Clyde weighing in on the ones and twos and on the MIC. Thanks a lot, Clyde. Last Thursday, one more step was taken toward history as Mark John. What, how do you say that name? Mark Janak? Joniah. Mark Joniah. He's looking to become the first assemblyman elected to the Bronx. All right. By the early hours of Friday morning, Janaj, that's how you say that, was leading by more than 500 votes, enough for the victory over incumbent Naomi Rivera in the Bronx's 80th district, which includes the Van Ness, Morris Park, Pelham Parkway, Pelham Gardens, Pelham Bay, Allerton, Norwood, and Van Cortlandt Village. Mr. Janaw won the Democratic primary and looks to become the representative from the 80th district during elections in November. So stay tuned for that. Make sure you exercise your right to vote. Get out there and take care of business, because a lot of people paid the price so that we can do so. So we offer our congratulations to Mark Janaj. All right. It's today in Open. Well, Wednesday, Darren Hyme. You can check out a whole lot more with that. He has that complete coverage of all things happening right here in Bronx politics. So you make sure you check out my man, Darren Hyme. All right, we've got to take a quick break. But up next, when we come back, well, we got the Open Nutrition Consultant, Fiorella DeCarlo. She's going to join us. We got some beautiful things, beautiful information, wonderful information to share with you. So don't go anywhere. We got you.
G morning, sunshine. Wakey, wakey. Text me. Are your parents home later? We can hang. LUV, love you. JK. Holla back.
Are you with your friends? That's lame.
We're in a huge fight right now.
XO.
What'd you dream about?
Something I did.
Are you on your way to the
mall? I'm lonely.
Nude pics. Send me some. Text me.
Every year, mothers lose their babies to gun crimes. You'll always be your mother's baby. So before you commit a gun crime, think about who you'll leave behind. Gun crimes hit home.
Gotta be careful. Oh, I must be careful. Well, that's a nice picture.
Come on, Anna.
Okay.
Foreclosure doesn't affect just you. It affects your whole family, too. If you've fallen behind on your mortgage, we can help. Call 1-888-995-HOPE, because nothing is worse than doing nothing.
Hi, I'm Sonia Richards of the 2008 U.S. Track and Field Team. I'm here with our friends from Jane and the Dragon to say
The amount counts, so keep portions under control.
When you're on the go, there's nothing better than a healthy snack to give you a boost. But remember, portions count too.
I love fast food. Fruit, that is. It's the perfect size and great to eat on the fly.
You've got the idea. For fun ways to get healthy, visit www.smallstep.gov.
Two outs with a runner on first base. Now the big guy comes off the bat, hitting 342 with 92 RBIs and 36 homers. Thank you.
chill raw and prepared foods promptly. 1 in 6 Americans will get sick from food poisoning this year. Keep your family safer. Check your steps at foodsafety.gov.
Welcome back, everybody. DJ Ku Klan on the ones and twos. You know, our first guest is a registered dietitian who today will inform us about childhood nutrition and what parents can do to make sure their children are and remain healthy. So please welcome back our good friend and our open nutrition consultant, Fiorella DiCarlo. We welcome you
Thank
to the show.
Thank you so much.
Always a pleasure to see you. You always have some wonderful ideas and information for us.
Thank you.
Now, this nutrition, childhood development nutrition, what's that all about?
Well, you know, there's a lot of, you know, things going on out there today with the emphasis on childhood obesity. Mm-hmm. And while it is a very, very, very important topic, and there's so many programs that are going into school and school food and their school lunches and so on, there's one thing that I'm a little concerned about, and that is at the same time while trying to combat the obesity problem, mm-hmm. we're also creating an environment where you also stigmatizing obesity in the sense that it can also create certain eating issues with children. Early on, there's an entire generation right now that's growing up around this idea of, you know, beat obesity, the obesity epidemic. There are these ads out there, you know, with pictures of overweight children saying, you know, this is an overweight child that could be an overweight adult. So imagine going to school as an overweight child right now and knowing that everyone is discussing this obesity epidemic. What does that do to them psychologically? Like, does it produce more eating issues or discomfort with their own body?
So it weighs on the psyche?
Yes, yes. So there's it's a double-edged sword in a sense, mm-hmm. you know. So of course, you know, I really commend everyone doing everything that they can to make sure that families and children and schools are doing the best that they can to educate children to make sure that they're eating properly.
But
there is that other thing. So just imagine what it is psychologically. Could it induce sort of eating issues or body issues? You know, what does one do one if one is overweight at that point? Yeah. How is it suggested? So for me, I think we need to attack this in kind of two ways. First is to educate mm-hmm. about literally nutrition, and the other is to create an atmosphere where children's relationship to food is healthy. Mm-hmm. So there's a couple of ways of doing that too. So the first thing, just nutritionally, what generally children at that age group need is, number one, they need iron. And they need that for energy, so they have to make sure that they're having enough of that in their diet, and their parents make sure. There's ways of getting that in different types of animal meats, and you would choose lean meats. And then there's other ways that you can get it in vegetarian sources like spinach and kale and other vegetables.
Or you can get your child involved in some sport, maybe karate, volleyball. Mm-hmm. Because this is a great discipline when you're associated with like a sport or like karate.
Yes.
And they will tell you, all right, you need to eat this, you need to be very disciplined to be a part of this, what we're doing here.
Well, physical activity in general, you know, is enormous. And that's another thing that we see in a certain generation, particularly in an urban environment where there's not a lot of places to go out and go, you know, have activity and have sports. So it's very important to put that in someone's lifestyle and mm-hmm. sort of get them out off the couch and get out and be active and have fun as a child. And the other second thing to look at, of course, is calcium and vitamin D, because of course at that time, at that stage, making sure that you have the best possible bone mass, which will take you into adulthood, which will pretty much impact how you will be in adult in terms of your bone mass or bone loss. So it's very important to get that dairy, perhaps 3 times a day, low-fat milk, you know, and things of that sort.
But what about the childhood development? I mean, before the child is born, mm-hmm. what should parents be doing?
When
nutritionally,
right? So they're in prenatal nutrition, some of the same ideas are intact
because that contributes also to childhood obesity, does it?
A lot of studies do show that the obesity that the parents may have, their weight and their diet during the prenatal care will somehow, you know, affected mm-hmm. the later life of the child. So pretty much the same thing would happen with mothers in mm-hmm. terms of making sure that they're eating a balanced diet, they have an adequate amount of protein, adequate amount of iron, calcium, vitamin D, folic acid to prevent any sort of birth defect of any kind, yeah. and any sort of fish oil omega-3s are great because they've been shown to promote, you know, cognitive development in the child.
Yes.
You know, but once you get into the childhood, like I was saying, is that the relationship to the food, not just the food, is also what's really important.
Sure, sure.
And one of the major things is to teach your child what it means to be hungry and what it means to be full. Because if you are always rewarding your child or placating your child or calming your child mm-hmm. or distracting your child with food, they may end up becoming emotional eaters later.
Yeah.
So your child should learn that they need to eat when they're hungry. So the first question should be, are you hungry? And if they are, they can have whatever snack. If they're not, perhaps they're looking for something else. Perhaps
sure.
it's attention, perhaps it's just some sort of soothing. And so therefore, you don't want to mix those signals up for them moving forward as an adult, because we know how emotional you can be an emotional eater as adults. So
right.
it starts somewhere.
It brings me back to my childhood, Ku Klux. You know, we had a big family. It was 9 of us, you know, living in a 3-bedroom apartment. And I tell you, if something hit the refrigerator, we hit it right away.
Yeah.
It didn't last in that refrigerator right away. So, you know, you just ate when you saw some food. No, it wasn't that unorganized, but, you know.
Right, right.
You know, you eat when you can.
Right, and, you know, and everyone, you know, parents are so concerned about having always snack packs with them. You know, and or at the dinner table, distracting them with something else. Like that, you'll see a lot of in restaurants, the child is distracted by watching yeah. some, you know, thing on their computer instead of mindfully eating and, you know, right. enjoying their food.
Yes.
The other issue is how do you, if you do have an overweight child, how do you propose to have a healthy environment in the home? And one of the things is to start to focus on the healthy aspects of food. Like, for example, we're going to eat healthy. These are healthy foods versus we need to go on a diet and you need to somehow alter your body. Because then you're sending the message to them that what their body is not right. It's wrong.
Mm-hmm.
And so the way that you approach in, you know, putting in healthy is very important,
yes,
because
yes.
they internalize that as there's something wrong. And it's not just for children.
Not only
for
have
children.
A developing body, you have a developing mind.
Absolutely. Happening. And you have to imagine how that affects someone, yeah. you know, and not only for the overweight child, but for the child who is not overweight but is afraid to be overweight and stigmatized.
Yeah.
Children now, it used to be that you needed to go through puberty and be 13, 14, 15 before you started to be concerned about the way that you look. Now it's starting very, very early. You have 6, 7, 8-year-olds who want to go on a diet, who want to, you know, or think that they don't have the ideal body and so on. So these messages are getting into
sure.
their heads very, very early on.
Yeah, people going to, I mean, I saw this program the other day, and kids will take the summer break and go get their face done and nose done and, you know, and come in high school.
Right, 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 right. And,
yeah.
and earlier and earlier you'll see it, and also with boys now.
Yeah. So how should parents lead by example?
Well, one of the things is the parent has to be also very aware of their own relationship to food, because that's the biggest thing that can be transferred onto their child. If the mother or the father have some sort of body issue or food relationship issue, they most certainly will carry it on to the child. So first is awareness to what you're doing around food, you know,
mm-hmm.
and having the diet mentality.
So don't have Thanksgiving every day, right?
Right, right.
You can cook, but it can be like for some people cook for a couple of days. So
right.
you have leftovers.
Right. And there are those who tend to overeat or compulsively overeat or emotionally eat.
Yeah.
The other flip side of that coin are people who are way, way, way too concerned with the diet mentality and
mm-hmm.
restrict too much.
Mm-hmm.
And when they restrict too much, they create that also dissonance with a child in their relationship with food, where there's good and bad. And if they ever eat good food or
yeah.
bad food, it means something more to them.
So people tell us we should eat 3 times a day.
Mm-hmm.
How often should we really eat?
Well, again, if you're going based on your hunger, and really that is the ultimate, besides all the rules and regulations, it's your body's signals telling you, do you feel hungry? If you literally feel hungry, and that means a slight stomach growling before
mm-hmm.
you get super hungry,
yeah.
that's hunger. Not just a snacky, not just, you know, I have a craving for something, but literally hungry, that's when you should eat. Typically, that happens between every 3 to 4 hours, because that's how long it takes for you to kind of get rid of what you just ate and
yeah.
your metabolism to move on, typically. But the best source, how do you find out, is how hungry you are. And then when you start to eat, you know, you want to stop midway and say, hey, you know, am I full? Do I need more? Do I not? And you can assess for yourself.
So listen to your digestive system.
And listen to your body. That's right. It's very, very important. And the final thing I think for children to really get a good idea about food is to be involved in the food selection, in the food preparation, so that they know what real food is. And they can create a really healthy relationship with food so that they can make it themselves and learn how to, you know, cook and be part of the process.
Our registered dietitian. She's always on the scene, always with some great information. If you want to call, give her a big round of applause, everybody. Yay. Okay. Now, where can people get more information?
Fitwithfiorella.com.
Say it again?
Fitwithfiorella.com.
Fiorella.com. All right. Thank you so much.
Of course.
Always a pleasure
of
to see you.
Thank
Thanks
you.
For the wonderful information.
Of course.
All right, we're going to take another break right here, but coming up next, Clarence Stanley will be here. Don't change the channel. We'll be right back with more on the Dr. Bob Lee.
G-Morning Sunshine, text me back. LUV, love you. JK. Holla back. Holla back.
Are you with your friends? That's lame.
We're in a huge fight right now. XO.
What'd you dream about?
Something I did.
Are you on your way to the mall?
Lonely. Nude pics. Send me some. Text me.
Big dreams and good grades aren't enough to get into college. There are actual steps you need to take. Finding someone who can help is the first and most important. For the next steps, go to knowhowtogo.org.
These things we count on every day started as ideas. Ideas from the minds of African Americans. Support minority education today so we don't miss out on the next big idea tomorrow. The United Negro College Fund. A mind is a terrible thing to waste.
Hey, how's it going?
Sir, are you okay? Two, three, four, five, six.
I'm sure it'll go
seven,
away.
Eight,
go away?
Nine,
sir, that
10,
can't be good.
11,
no, it's cool.
12,
really?
13,
do you want a napkin or
something? 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20.
You wouldn't ignore this, so why ignore the signs of a stroke? At the first warning signs, call 911 immediately, because time lost is brain lost.
And hey, welcome back, everybody. Our guests are here to speak on the Small Bronx Business Development Center and how it helps business with things such as accounting and tax strategies. And here to shed more light is the director of the SBDC here at Lehman College.
Good morning.
Clarence Stanley is here again.
Good to see you.
Welcome.
Again.
Always a pleasure to see you, too.
Pleasure's mine.
Yes. All right. So you have these wonderful things happening. What is the Small Business Development Center all about?
Okay, basically, Bob, is to talk about getting businesses and economic development. Our mission is to help people realize their dreams and to create jobs. You know, most folks don't realize that 97% of the folks in this country work for small businesses.
Yes.
They don't work for the IBM, they're in business for themselves. So what we do is, if you want to turn this economy around, to try and encourage, tell businesses what they need to do in terms of business planning, business strategies, financial planning. We will help them right here at Lehman College at the Small Business Development Center at a cost that they can afford. It's free, and it's right here. We have certified business advisors on staff that will work with small businesses to help them in any facet. We do research, whatever a business needs. Now, we're funded by the U.S. Small Business Administration, and now we are partnering with the other government agencies to try and turn this economy around. And these are tough economic times. We're starting to see things starting to look look better.
Do you get any help from the Obama administration?
Absolutely. This is probably, I'm kind of passionate. I guess you can't talk about politics on here, but,
yeah, you know. Yeah, you can go.
Okay, well, you know, the The Small Business Administration has been strongly supported by the president and this administration. Mm-hmm. We've got some programs in place that have made access to capital more affordable for small businesses and made it more accessible for small business. And there's been an effort now to try and get businesses to get into focusing now on international trade, trying to show folks how to start exporting more, to show businesses that, you know, the United States, we only make up a small percentage of the Earth's population. There's 7.5 billion people on Earth, and there were 300 million Americans, and we don't sell to that other population. So now I'm trying to encourage our small businesses in the United States to start exporting their products to grow. This is, I'm talking about the little small mom-and-pop stores.
This is election season. Who should small businesses vote for?
This is an interesting subject. You know, it's like, you know, unfortunately, the government is a big employer, and we want to try and scatter a little bit. Now, who's favorable for small business versus big business? There's always been a discussion, Democrats versus Republicans. And there's different theories. Republicans feel under trickle-down economics, where if the money goes to a large corporation, they'll be in a position to hire more, which may be some validity to that. Yeah. I'm on the other stream, and I think that you got to build it from the bottom up. Mm-hmm. And so you feed small businesses, you feed the individuals, and you kind of feed that middle America and let them grow.
You know, small businesses may turn into a large business.
Small business, you know, Staples was a small business. Yeah. You know, and you think about the small businesses that were real small, you know, and yeah, you see Facebook. Well, Facebook's stock is going down, but we see a young man taking a small business and becoming a billionaire. Now, we're not all going to be millionaires or billionaires, but we can certainly find a way, if you do it right, to make a decent living.
Yeah, and you're helping a lot of people do this.
And create jobs. Yes. That's what we do. This year, we will actually counsel about 600 businesses, and we've actually raised about... our goal was $7.5 million. We're going to hit that goal this year.
Oh, beautiful.
Okay, and that's the small businesses, Bob.
Let's talk about tax strategies.
You know, there's a lot
of tax strategies for small business.
One of the biggest problems that most businesses have, when they come to me for a loan, and they talk about, I ask, well, I need, in order for you to get some finance, the bank needs to see your tax return.
Yes.
And I want to put a good face on IRS. A lot of folks are afraid of IRS. A lot of folks try to keep, you know, when you go to your tax preparer, they say, I want you to do me a favor. Get my taxes down. Make it so I don't pay very little taxes. And in some cases, let's not report certain things. Well, I'm trying to turn that around. That you're going to come to me for a loan. The bank wants to see one thing. They want to see that you can pay them back.
Yeah, yeah.
And so businesses tend, in some cases, not all businesses, but quite a few businesses come in, and they show that there's inadequate cash flow to cover a loan.
So there's something wrong.
So there's something wrong. If you understand the tax code, and we did a workshop last week, a couple weeks on tax strategies, tax planning strategies for small business. Uh-huh. So you understand the tax code and that you should pay your employees and yourself. Okay, and there are ways that you can get certain tax reductions, legal tax reductions.
Yeah.
So when you come to the bank and you put it, you bring a tax return into me, I say, look, you know what? This gentleman has positive cash flow. You know, he took advantage of the accelerated depreciation. The bank will add that back to the loan statement.
Yeah.
I said, okay, guess what? And he's got a 401k. He's got a retirement plan. He's done a lot of sophisticated things. Well, I want to bring my businesses, my clients in the Bronx, to that level of thinking. Uh-huh. To come in and one really important thing is that the employees that are working for you pay a guy cash at the end of the year. You know, he's not getting Social Security. He's not entitled to unemployment. So let's just do it right. Mm-hmm. So we're trying to show businesses now, let's get you to from I don't want to use the word underground businesses, but let's come above ground because there are legal ways to do this.
Yeah.
And my job is as your tax planner, and I tell everyone, you know, there are accountants and there are tax preparers. You need to talk to get a good tax preparer, someone that kind of knows what they're doing and can kind of advise.
He knows both sides. He knows the tax laws and he knows what you're looking for also.
And knows how to help you grow your business. You know, we've got small businesses. You know, we've got a guy with a push cart.
Yeah.
Now, push car starts. Next thing you know, the guy's got a manufacturing plant.
Of course.
You need your accountant, your tax preparer to help you do that.
I watched it happen. I saw a guy, he had a shopping cart picking up pieces of metal along the highway.
Okay.
He brought a little station wagon, started throwing things in the back of that. Next thing you know, he had a van, got a truck.
Yep.
And he was just collecting stuff, and he would bring it down to these plants where they collected metal. So they would decipher the metal into these different areas, like, I don't know, tin, iron, into these aluminum, copper, and now he owns one of those big plants.
There you go. See, that's so. What we're offering here at the Lehman at the Small Business Center is, is whatever services the business might need. You know, if you need to incorporate yourself, mm-hmm. you know, the difference, should you become a corporation, a sole proprietor, LLC? Yeah, LLC is kind of involved, but if you talk to some accountants, I'm not an LLC person. I say you need to set up a C corporation and switch it over to an S corporation. But let us do it for you.
Yeah.
And there is no charge for us to do that. Okay, and we actually now sign agreements with not just the IRS, because IRS, when you have an IRS issue, we have these enrolled agents that will work with you
yeah.
to help you address the IRS. We're working with the bankers to help, because the banks are in business to make money.
Yeah. Well, sometimes, you know, people watching us, it seems like we're talking in the dark because they didn't reach this point yet. They may just have that idea that they want to start a business.
Right.
But don't know which direction to take it in. All right, they have this wonderful idea. What do they do next?
That's a nice segue into my talking about this, our classes at Lehman College. You know, we have
yes.
now have the school, we call the School of Continuing and Professional Studies.
Uh-huh.
Beginning October 1st, what we've done is taken our workshops and put them into smaller modules within the college. Okay, these modules, there are three sessions, three and four sessions on the business planning, putting together a business plan.
I like it.
Putting together yes. your financial plans, putting together your marketing plan, dealing with the tax strategies.
So go from business 101 all the way in.
And it's a 12-week session.
Oh, beautiful.
And we made it affordable. What we did is try to say, let's put these things down, make them affordable. By the way, shout out to veterans. If you're a veteran, make sure you take advantage of the GI Bill.
There you go.
And you can use the GI Bill to take these classes here, continuing education as well as your academic classes.
We applaud our veterans. Thank you for your service.
Thank you for your
Where
service.
Where can we get more information on this?
By all means, you can go to you can call us, obviously, 718-960-8806. Or ideally go to the SBA, two websites. One is www.sba.gov. That's the Small Business Administration. Or www.nyssbdc.org.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, that's New York State Small Business Development Center website. And we whatever counsel you might need, whatever research you might need, go right online and we can work with you.
Yeah, contact Stanley, Clarence Stanley, director right here at Lehman College. He'll make you rich. Call him now.
Thank you again.
Thank you so much. All right, we got to take another quick break, but up next, Charles Cooper is going to be here. We'll tell you more. Stay right there. I've got you.
My sport is football, but my passion is education.
Right up here.
So every year, I take promising high schoolers on a college tour to show them that higher education means a brighter future.
My name is Namdi Asamoah. I don't just wear the shirt, I live it.
Find out how you can live United for Education. Give, advocate, volunteer. Go to liveunited.org.
Do you wear this?
How you doing? I just want a regular, no sugar today.
You got it.
Thanks. Hello.
Hi.
Did you eat that whole thing today?
Yeah.
Yes.
Hi, how are you doing?
She's getting big, huh?
Big. Yeah, she is big. Hey, haircut.
Yeah.
Yeah, looks cute. Well, let's go. Nice to see you. Thanks a lot.
If only child abuse were this easy to recognize. If you even suspect abuse, call 1-800-4-A-CHILD. All calls are anonymous and confidential. Trust your instincts.
Megan, you're a tramp. Ryan Fitch told me you guys made out. Everybody knows. He says you're the most desperate girl he knows, besides your mom. How many boyfriends does she have anyway? Lots? That zit is huge. Zit face. Ugly.
Kitchen surfaces, utensils, and hands with soapy water. 1 in 6 Americans will get sick from food poisoning this year. Keep your family safer. Check your steps at foodsafety.gov.
So here are the keys.
Congratulations, it's officially yours. I'm sure you'll have many happy years here.
Except for you, because you'll be gone 3 years from now, struck down by the same disease that got your father. So you won't be around for them. And sadly, it could have been detected early with a simple test, but you didn't have it. Okay, who wants to check out the backyard?
For a list of tests every man should have, go to ahrq.gov.
I'm lucky. Let me help you with that. I get to do something I love. It has nothing to do with touchdowns or titles.
Everybody bring it in.
I get to play a part in the life of someone just starting out.
How many of you think homework is just as important as teamwork?
I help keep kids in school.
Good.
And that's the name of the game.
My name is LaDainian Thomason. I don't just wear the shirt. I live it.
Give. Advocate. Volunteer. Live United.
Catch my knee, baby. Broke it on.
Hey, welcome back, DJ Kool Klide, cutting it up on the ones and twos.
Sick.
Our next guest is a spokesperson for the African Day Parade, which will take place this Sunday on September 23rd. It's expected to attract more than 50 marching groups of over 60,000 people. Here with us now is Charles Cooper. We welcome you to the show.
Thank you, Bob. Thanks for inviting us.
Yeah. We just had the African American Day Parade that came up across 125th Street. You know, Will was out there.
Of course.
Hal Jackson was always broadcasting from there, too.
Of course.
So now we have to do yours. It's coming Sunday.
Yes. And I would like to say we were active in the African American Day Parade as well.
Yes.
The African Day Parade focuses on the culture of the continent. A continent of Africa and the diaspora, because you know everything stems from Africa, you know, and it transcends as you go to South America and North America, etc. So we're looking to highlight, bring all those groups together, such as the Garifunas, groups from Cote d'Ivoire, groups from Eritrea, groups from South Africa, group from my country, Liberia.
Yeah.
So I'm looking forward to it. We've been very blessed to have sponsors on board to back us to the end, such as Intergy, such as Dash Media, elected officials that from the beginning, because organizing a parade is not an easy thing at all.
No, not at all. And you have the police commissioner coming down too to
Yes, he is. Along with other dignitaries from the UN. And you know, it for the countries and the groups that participate is a big deal for that.
So you're very excited about this upcoming parade.
I am.
What are we going to expect this year?
Well, expect everything. You know, we have groups that are coming from Liberia, groups that are coming from Ivory Coast, groups that are coming from Cote d'Ivoire.
That's last year's, right?
Yes. Now, this year parade is going to be even bigger. We have groups that are coming as far as California to the Carolinas, to South America. We have Brazilian group. So this is a big melting pot. This reflects New York City, you know.
Yeah. So tell us about some of the cuisine, the music. There's going to be a lot of good food because you probably have an after party to start off with breakfast or something like that.
Of course. My favorite food is cassava leaf.
Cassava leaf.
And rice.
Yeah.
And okra. And interesting enough, and that's why when I look at culture, the similarities, because in Liberia we make this okra sauce.
Yeah.
And when I left Liberia, because there was the civil unrest there, and we came to the U.S., one of the things that reminded me of home was the okra sauce.
The okra here.
The okra middle. The connection of food. But one of my favorite musicians, ever since I was a little boy, Babino, he's going to be performing.
Oh,
yeah.
Wonderful.
First heard of him in Sierra Leone.
Uh-huh.
Because, you know, during the war, a lot of Liberians left Liberia to go to Sierra Leone. Yeah. So from Sierra Leone, came to the U.S. here. But that was one of the first music I heard, and you know, it's one of those things that you hear.
Did you bring some of the music with you?
I wish, Clyde.
What's music from Africa, man.
But I'm a fan of some of the new stuff too. You know, we have B-Clean and Isaac here, and they're up and coming musicians, artists in the African
community.
So
we'll get a chance to hear some today.
Oh, yeah, of course.
We got to hear some music.
Bob,
you bring the food with the music?
We have something for you. Not the food today, but Sunday, September 23rd.
There's no okra in the house today?
I promise you, next time we come, I'll bring you the authentic Liberian okra sauce.
There you go. All right. Can you eat it for breakfast?
No, you don't want to eat it for breakfast. It's a little heavy because, you know, usually when we eat okra sauce, we eat it with rice.
Yes.
And it's so heavy. So it's more of a lunch, dinner thing.
Oh, good, good.
Yeah.
All right, so we're going to have a lot. We got the food. We got the music. We got countries. How many countries are represented?
Well, there's over 40 countries represented. Organizing it has been a challenge, of course.
Well, you got the UN involved, right? You got
the whole continent of Africa.
Yeah.
In the diaspora, it's important. Diaspora, you know, we have the Garifunas, they're involved. And, you know, the history of them is they originally came from Africa and they moved to
South America.
And they've been able to keep their African traditions alive and so forth. So we're excited. The groups that have come out that wanted to be that's participating in this, you know, it's astounding.
A lot of South American countries, Central America too.
Yes.
They have people from Africa that have occupied that area there, and it's still there. Brazil.
I was in Salvador, Bahia.
Yeah, there it is. Right in Brazil.
Brazil, a year and a half ago, and it was my first time there. And when you're there, you realize how apparent the African culture is. Mm-hmm. You know, you see women with lapa and a head wrap.
That's
I could be back home. So
go to drbobley.com. I have a featured little video in there.
You know,
from Africa.
Okay, I have to check that out.
And from Brazil too.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. You know, it's wonderful. It's wonderful.
So we got to get in there and just be a part of it.
Of course.
Bronx Net cameras. Get it together. Here we go.
Let's do it.
We're going to go check it out and bring it back next week.
Let's do it.
So this parade is coming up Sunday.
Yes, Sunday, September 23rd. Uh-huh. It's going to start around 11. It's going to run from 135th on Lenox. It's going to run on Lenox from 135th to 119th. Then it's going to curve in and go into Marcus Garvey Park. Marcus Garvey Park, that component is going to start around 3:30, and that's going to be the festival.
Yeah.
Festival soundstage.
Watch out. We're going to give it to you. Watch out.
So it's going to be an awesome event.
Yeah. How important is it to keep this rich culture alive, celebrate traditions? Because, you know, a lot of people, it's like watered down in the city sometimes.
Yeah.
But, you know, especially for a lot of the young people.
Yeah.
And I think I think the adults should come together and say, hey, you know, these are rich traditions and cultures, and this is where your ancestors came from.
Of course.
Let people know.
You know, we've had similar conversations like that. I serve on the Bronx Board President African Advisory Council. And you know, the Bronx itself has over 80,000.
Ruben Diaz Jr., big up to you. Ruben Diaz Jr., Bronx Borough President.
Bronx Borough President. But in the Bronx, we have over 80,000 Africans. Mm-hmm. And that's just on census. And one of the discussions was, you know, you have the new generation. Mm-hmm. And they don't realize how rich that culture is. So that day actually exposes them to the richness of that culture. But also, Africa is a big place.
Oh, yeah.
You know, the culture in West Africa, even in Liberia, is different from the culture in Eritrea or in Cote d'Ivoire. Mm-hmm. So it not only educate Africans that are here, second, third, fourth generations, but also African-Americans, the community. Mm-hmm. Everyone's able to get something from it.
When did you come to this country?
I came here when I was 12 years old.
Did you notice any difference between the Africans in your country and African Americans in this country?
Because
we had a big argument, not an argument, like a dialogue when we were in Africa, you know, on how they saw us and how we saw them.
You know what? Liberia is an interesting place because the history of Liberia was founded by free men and women from the U.S. that went back, and Liberia comes from the Latin word liberty.
Right.
So we have a lot of the cultures here, but also we cherish our indigenous culture, you know, the Pele, the Bassa culture as well. Coming here, of course, it was a culture shock because we're in Africa, you know, you hear, you know, the land of the free, streets paved with gold.
Yeah.
You know, I remember coming here as a child. It was in the middle of winter.
So it was my first time seeing snow.
So what the heck is this? I heard about it. This is cold, too.
So imagine that shock, you know.
Yeah.
But you adapt. I was lucky to have family, loving family. But, you know, it took a while.
Yeah. So we have this big parade. Give us the date and where it's coming, where it's going to start, and all that stuff.
Today is September 23rd. It's going to run from 11 to 7.
Sunday.
Yeah. The parade going to run from 11 to 3.
Get there early.
And the festival, space is limited. So first come, first serve. It's going to run from 3:30 to 7. We have artists coming from everywhere, from Ghana, Cote d'Ivoire, local artists here. Our sponsors, like I said before, I have to mention them because they've been backing us 100%. Entergy, Dash Media, Senator Perkins' office, who basically opened his office up and he said, listen, you guys, go ahead.
Senator Bill Perkins, big up to you.
Big up to you.
All right, so we got the music, we got the fun, food for the whole family. It's going to be a wonderful cultural, traditional
extravaganza.
Thing. African Day Parade. Of course, indeed. The 23rd.
I'm hoping to see you there.
I will be there. Okay. Well, let me see what I got to do. Let me not speak before I can. Yeah, I'm going to try my best to be there. But thank you so much.
Charles Cooper,
spokesperson for the African Day Parade. And I know it's going to be wonderful.
It is, Bob.
Yes, it is.
It is.
All right, we'll be right back. And we got some music from the culture?
Yes, we are.
They're waiting. They're eager.
No, who's going to be here?
We have B-Clay and we have Isaac.
Alrighty.
Two up-and-coming artists, you know, loved in the community. And I can't wait to hear what they have in store.
All right, that's coming up next right here on Open. We'll be right back.
All right. Hey, Bob, is it possible for me to get the time? Sar ki jo sar se wo dheere dheere पागल हूँ अरे मैं धीरे धीरे सर की जो सर से वो धीरे धीरे पागल हूँ अरे मैं धीरे
Separate raw meats from other foods by using different cutting boards. 3,000 Americans will die from food poisoning this year. Keep your family safer. Check your steps at foodsafety.gov.
This is one amazing truffula tree. Can you imagine a place where these grow everywhere? Yes, it's called the Forest. A magical place to enjoy with your family. So discover the forest and explore all the wonder that's there. Visit discovertheforest.org to find a forest near you.
Foods to the right temperature using a food thermometer. 3,000 Americans will die from food poisoning this year. Keep your family safer. Check your steps at foodsafety.gov.
Coming home can be hard if you're a veteran of Iraq or Afghanistan. You may feel like you're all alone. But you're not alone. At IAVA.org, your fellow vets are all around you. Join our free online community. Get the resources you need. And connect to other vets who know where you're coming from. IAVA.org. We've got your back.
Welcome back to Open, everybody. I'm your host, Dr. Bob Lee, hanging out with DJ Kool Clyde on the ones and
sick.
Toot, toot.
Sick.
And the beat goes on and on and on. We continue our Open Music Mondays. Check it out.
Sip.
Our next guests have performed at venues such as the Apollo Theater. Let's see, the world-famous Apollo Theater on September 23rd. They will be performing at the African Day Parade. So without further ado, please welcome to the open stage, B. Clain, Isaac Katale! Hey!
Yeah, my name is B. Clain, born in Ghana from Nigeria, parents, and I have Isaac.
Isaac Katale from the Congo, the Democratic Republic of the Congo.
And we're performing at the African Day Parade and Festival, September 23rd. You don't want to miss that. Isaac, give me some, give me some, give me some. Check it. Oh, na 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 na. Oh, na 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 na. Oh, na na na. I like your caramel skin and your Betty Boom figure. Sexy and you know it, you can get any nigga. Say them pocket big and you can say your pocket bigger. Turn, 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 turn. Pay dancing say that you full of style. Help me and some money know me woulda take a shopping all the while. Yes, I keep the loving stockpile. Body look so tight, nobody coulda guess you. Turn, 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 turn.
Turn! Abayayabayayabayayaba silike mama. Alega pe inyo gabi soto sinige. Ah, tobi namadu. Yo yo. Ah, yo yo. Ale tobi namadu. Suma yo yo. Ale yo yo.
What's up, pretty young girl? The way you do me controls how I feel it. I can see us getting down. What's the deal? What's the deal? And what's up, pretty young girl? The way you do me controls how I see it. Hey, 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 turn, 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 four! Manaso, 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 manaso.
Thank you guys.
Give them a big round of applause, everybody. You guys are great. So you're going to be doing this at the African Day Parade,
definitely,
right?
Definitely.
I should grab a seat here. Look, I can hit a knee.
You know, it's a family event. Whenever we get a chance, we really want to showcase to others, you know, how we move, how we eat, so that that cultural exchange should happen.
Definitely.
Like my brother and I, we're coming from different nations of Africa.
Yeah.
We unite just for this cause as well, so that we can show people. Like, together we are strong.
Yeah. Definitely, definitely.
Now, you come from Nigeria?
Yeah, I was actually born in Ghana. My parents from Nigeria. Yeah. So I'm from both countries, actually.
And you come from?
I was born and raised in the Republic Democratic of Congo.
Yeah, yeah.
My father's from Guinea. My mother's from the Congo. So I was born and raised over there.
Yeah, what's the language there? French?
The official language is French, but we have four major other languages that we use as official language. Swahili, Chiluba, Lingala, and Kikongo. But the Congo has like more than 400 dialects.
You speak Kikongo?
Kikongo, I can vibe and sing in them.
You can?
But I speak Lingala mainly.
Yeah.
Lingala is what I speak.
And I heard you say, oh, na, 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 na,
definitely. That's just a high before I start singing. In Ghana, we have a lot. Oh, my God, we have so many languages. We have the Twi, we have the Gan, we have the Dakati, we have Ewe. And
is
also,
there one main language that will get everybody on the same page?
Wow. We have a popular language, maybe the Twi or the Gan. That's the main, I would say the main language.
Everybody understands.
And also in Ghana, in Nigeria, sorry, we have the Yoruba, the Igbos, and then the Hausas. Yeah.
So how did you guys meet, though?
Harlem, Shrine, right?
Yeah.
In Harlem?
Yeah.
It's a serendipitous.
Uptown, together, all right. Yeah. That's what I'm talking about.
Yeah, he was actually playing outside. Acoustic, and I'm like, yo, I like this guy. So I reach out to him, like, can we do something together outside here? And then we were singing, he was playing the guitar, I was doing my thing, and everybody was watching.
New York is really the place, you know, New York is really the place. The privilege we have, we get the best of all worlds in here. I usually say I started my vision in the Congo because you have different tribes in Kinshasa coming together, but New York give us the whole world together.
That's true.
Like, we can sit, you know, brothers. Serendipitously, we're bumping into each other. We're doing what we love to do.
Yeah.
How did you meet Charles?
Wow, you know, through a lot of networking.
The interesting thing about it is that, you know, the African community, although it's large, it's very small. You know, you bump heads. I think the first time I met you guys was through Kone. Kone is he's one of the organizers of the African Day Parade. He's actually the founder of it. And ever since then, you know, you notice talent. I had to tell these guys, I was like, September 23rd, I don't care what you're doing.
You have to.
We need to have you guys on board. Ever since then, I think we've just been working together on board with different community projects in the community, getting the community out and involved. Because this event, you know, it's not our event. It's the community event. It's about educating the community and our folks that's here also in the diaspora.
Yeah.
We're excited. We are excited.
So where can we get more information on the band, just in case people need you to come out and be a part of what they're doing?
We'll be performing at a parade.
Isaac Atala in the Lifelog Project.
We also have Carl Kusi from Ghana. He's actually in India now. He's flying in tomorrow morning. He's a big artist in Ghana. Yeah.
Simple Facebook follow up. You know, people can look at each person's project. They can be able to follow up the schedules of things that we're doing, you know, beside the parade and stuff.
Good.
And also we have flyers all over.
And you got to send us some music so we can play it on BronxNet.
Definitely.
And Levy at WBLS that plays African music. You know,
videos, music.
Give us your website one more time.
The website is www.africandayparade.org. And you can also catch us on Facebook and Twitter.
Mm. And on the band?
Isaac Atalai and the Lifelong Project on Facebook. Isaac Atalai and the Lifelong Project.
And it's Beakley Music. When you go to Beakley Music, you get our music.
Thank you so much. Give them a big round of applause, everybody. All right, that's about all. Continue doing it. All the time we have for today's show. Many thanks to all of our guests, all of our viewers for tuning in and checking it all out. Make sure you tune in and check out the Darren Jaime, all new show on Wednesday, all new opener, right? My man Darren Jaime doing his thing. Always remember this, what you are is God's gift to you, and what you make of yourself is your gift to God. So choose your choice and let your choice control the chooser. I'm the Dr. Bob Lee. Catch you on WBLS tonight right after the Quiet Storm with Lenny Green. I love you all. This is Open. We close. Peace.
Time is up. Our judges will give you their scores. Ready, set, go! Okay. Jason starts out with a multi-grain roll. Ooh, Allison stuffing her pita with, yes, spinach. A great source of iron. Jason isn't skipping on the protein, adding plenty of smoked turkey. It's like Allison's putting the finishing touches with crispy red bell peppers for a dose of vitamin A. Time! It looks like we have a tie. We'll need to call in our special guest referee.
Now, these are what I call quick, delicious lunches. Whole grain breads, a whole variety of ingredients. There are so many different ways to build delicious, healthy sandwiches. These two get high marks in every category. I'd say you're both winners. America.
Let's get healthy together.